I want to formally wish everybody on the panel and our audience good evening from Dubai, good afternoon Europe, and good morning America. My name is Sharad Agarwal. I'm the CEO of Cybergear, which is a Web 1 company I started in 1996. Back then, there was no Google, so we used to Yahoo. And if you guys remember, we had Alta Vista. I used to search on that. And I used to browse on Netscape. And I used to use a dial-up modem to connect, right? That's how we got connected to the internet back then. So now we should fast forward. And today, Cybergear is into the Web3 space. We are already building an NFT marketplace and advising some local brands on how to develop their metaverse strategy. When COVID happened some 18 months back, I launched onlywebinars.com, a platform for having engaging conversations such as this one. And today we are discussing designing the metaverse. In my opinion, or for me at least, it's 1996 all over again. Just imagine life. I mean, close your eyes, go back to 1996. There is no internet, right? Your life would come to a grinding halt. And I read somewhere that in today's Maslow's hierarchy of needs, Wi-Fi is higher than state of nirvana, right? So that's how much dependent we are on the internet. And I'm sure in tomorrow's world, we will all be living, working, and communicating in the metaverse. So today we have seven meta shapers on the panel. I like to call them early movers. And for me, they are rock stars because they've already taken the plunge and they will be sharing their experiences of how they've been building in the metaverse. It's time for me to introduce you to our facilitator for this webinar. It's my good friend, Susan Furness, who wears, you know, multiple hats. It's very difficult to introduce her because every time I do a webinar, she's added some new activity in her bio. But from what I can remember, she's a wordsmith. She's a strategic communications expert. She's into spiritual artistry and is an edge walker. So I think she multitasks. I like to think of her like an Intel processor, right? Totally multitasking. And I'm guessing that she's even ambidextrous. I'm going to hand it over to Susan to take this discussion forward. And I want to remind the audience, you can come in anytime through the chat. So let's keep the chat going and we'll take your questions towards the end of this conversation. Over to you, Susan.
Well, thank you so much, Sharad. And indeed, yes, a very, very big thank you to you because you were there right at the cusp of Web 2 as we know it today, you know, as Dubai's sort of, I think, trailblazer in the IT sector. And that's where I first met Sharad. He helped me with my very, very first website, you know, in and around like 1994, 95, 96, I can't remember. But Sharad, before we go on, I'm just seeing a question in the audience, you know, about this webinar format. Can you just remind us all that this is a webinar, so we all don't see all the all of the audience, we see the panelists only, is that correct?
Yeah, that's right. So audience can communicate with us through the chat, and we might even be able to get a few people on camera towards the end to interact with us and share their story.
Yeah, thank you so much. So just write in the chat, Sharad and I will be watching, and so will the rest of the panelists. And I'm gonna introduce you to those panelists now. You know, first on my screen next to me, the opposite side to Sharad, is you, Timothy. And so welcome from Hong Kong. Just give us, you know, 30 seconds, 90 seconds about yourself, Timothy.
Hi, thanks for having me. Good evening, everyone. So in the daytime, I'm head of digital for Rosewood Hotel Group, a luxury hotel company. And in the nighttime, I kind of fell into NFT about 6 months ago. So I'm an NFT trader, NFT educator, as well as a brand consultant for some NFT projects. One of them being a wearables project. So I think you know, it will be interesting to maybe share some of that later on in the conversation, since we're focusing on fashion today.
I think you're right. Sorry.
As you can hear, I'm from France, but I'm based in Hong Kong.
Thank you, Timothy. You're right. Brand is so important in all aspects of the business canvas, isn't it? But yes, today we're talking about designing the metaverse, you know, and using that as a stretch along, you know, so what do we all need to do to design a business model for the metaverse? And indeed, last month we talked about, you know, how are you future sensing that strategy? And of course, the strategy could be to stay out for now, but, you know, make it a strategy, right? You know, in or out, make sure you know that you've looked at why you're doing that to support your brand and your products and your company, your team, and everybody in this burgeoning space, this emerging market that, Sharad, I remember we mooted last time that pundits were saying in a decade could be worth 1.5 trillion. And I wouldn't be surprised in the 31 days since our last webinar that actually that number has shifted. So I'm going to go round to the bottom of my screen and ask someone who actually might know or not, and that's you, Moses Ma. You're there in the States, and you know, you really are at the entry port to Web3. Tell us, you know, a quick 30 seconds about yourself, and then, you know, what is happening out there at the minute in Web3, just very quickly.
So, really briefly, I run a venture incubator and an innovation consultancy. And a couple of lifetimes ago in internet years, I wrote the very first commercially successful internet video game, which was based on cyberspace. So you could connect. It was called Spectre VR. And you know, we packaged the Snow Crash book in it. So we were really heavy into it. But we knew that it would take a long time for the metaverse to be real. And it's taken over 20 years to get to where we are today. But anyway, a way to think about Web 1, Web 2, and Web 3 is that Web 1 was the idea of fully decentralized, that anybody could reach anybody. And then what Web 2 did is actually centralize around certain walled gardens like Facebook and Google. Web 3 is to uncentralize and then re-decentralize the internet in terms of DeFi and NFTs, with little Lego parts that you can snap together and then create content and other solutions. So I think it's very exciting. I think the NFT market itself just exploded in 1 year. It's gone to like 30 billion in trades. So I think it's something real, and it's definitely happening. But at the same time, it's like the Wild West. You could find gold, but there are going to be a lot of covered wagons killed by Indians along the way. There'll be the wreckage of many software companies, but I think the goal is worth chasing.
You paint an interesting picture there. And of course, designing the metaverse is all about creating business model canvases and painting those canvases three-dimensional if we need to, so that we really can get our businesses motoring in the metaverse or not. And as you're saying that, that wants to take me over to Italy, and that's you, Alberto Franco, because, you know, I remember that from your space as, you know, really being in the tech side of things, that you ask three questions when things like this are being discussed, and that's how. So tell us about you and tell us how.
Yeah, thank you very much, and thanks for having me. And I am a computer scientist, so that's exactly as you mentioned, Susan. I like to understand how things work. And what we are doing, and what I am doing as a day job, is building tools for then creating assets and digital products that then you can sell in the metaverse as NFTs or whatever kind of scenario you have in mind. So that's a small version of me, and that's what we do. So that's more or less it.
It's small and wide and very deep. We know that, Alberto. We'll be back to you later when we want to know how we're going to play Sunil, I can see you smiling from ear to ear there. You're in India today. How are you? Sunil, I mean, you know, like Moses, I mean, you bring like almost four decades to the room today, don't you? And you, Sharad, and me, I suppose. You know, we start adding up those decades. And you know, today we're putting a spotlight on fashion, Sunil. And you kicked off in the retail fashion sector and, you know, now doing very much to sort of help create a traceable and sustainable metaverse. Do you want to just sort of give us a bit about you and then lead us into that? And then we'll go into these fabulous team members here who are actually producing already. Over to you, Sunil.
Thank you, Suzanne. I'm Sunil Arora, and in the first 35 years of my career, I have mainly been on the education side of things. So it was mainly related to National Institute of Fashion Technology. I was lecturing over there, moved from NIFT to FIT New York, then London and Paris Schools of Fashion. So done a lot of work on consulting brands, manufacturers, sourcing companies, manufacturing companies globally in about 50 countries in that first 35 years. On various digital transformation services and various solution providings related to that. In the last 2 years, I have mainly been working on the digital fashion side of things and been advising and consulting with brands and sourcing companies on how metaverse and how digital fashion can be of great use to them and how this can also create a separate earning stream just out of a digital only fashion, which can slowly move towards the digital side of things to create something which is much more advanced than any kind of a forecasting or any kind of a trend analysis. So based on that, we are designing things. Our solutions are mainly started to be used in Trace Network, the new co-founded company of mine. We have already started getting on to various brands globally in about 50 countries right now. But out of that, I would say about 30 of them have started to utilize the digital side of things, the digital side of things in a very big way. And soon we are going to be launching these kind of things in Dubai, which is other office of ours. So that is what we are going to be doing. So thank you very much for having me here, and I discuss more as you ask me things.
Well, thank you to you, Sunil. And certainly we will be asking you because, you know, I sort of have only met you once and a lot online, but I sort of see the leader in you, the teacher in you and the mentor in you. So we want some of that. And I can see Mel smiling. So Mel, I mean, you, it's been an incredible sort of 18 months or so for you, hasn't it? And I know you're really sort of into conversation in this very interesting meta space, and specifically in NFT art. So Mel, hi, tell us about you and your art.
Greetings, thank you so much. I'm so happy to be here. My name is Mel Shapcott. I'm an abstract artist, a traditional artist. So I've been working as an artist for a long time. And since coming to the learning about Web3 and getting involved in NFTs, now I'm turning my own artwork into NFTs. It's allowed me to reach new markets, which are evolving and coming up as this whole Web3 starts to grow and emerge and change and transform. So it's been really exciting for me to take my traditional art and now turn it also into digital art, which is what I'm using for the NFTs. In addition to that, I have always been really inspired by promoting women in the arts. And so moving into Web3 has given me a real opportunity to help women through my company, Invisible Lotus, and artists as well, to utilize NFTs in their own businesses, in their own careers. So it's been really rewarding for me to be involved in the NFT space. Thank you, Susan.
You're welcome. It's rewarding for us as well to have you because we want to dive a bit into the NFT space in a minute. And so Timothy, Mel, particularly, you know, be ready for all of that. But let's go into sort of this dynamic duo who show how, you know, you can work very quickly by fusing two organizations together, the skill sets together. And that's you, Susanna, and you, Tracy. So, you know, I don't know which one of you wants to kick off. I mean, Susanna's got the big smile across her face. Tracy, should we start with Susanna? Is that okay?
Fine, yeah? Absolutely, yes.
Yeah, go on. Susanna, tell us about what you're doing, who you are, and then how you and Tracy are really making waves. Over to you.
Thank you, Susan. And I'm also very, very excited to be here. So thank you for the invitation. My name is Susanna Bastion, and I'm the founder of Jewels, which is the first NFT platform dedicated to virtual jewelry and other fashion accessories that can be worn through augmented and virtual realities. As you can see, I'm also wearing now one of our Jewels through augmented reality, these earrings. So Jewels, which stands for virtual jewels, was founded out of passion for fashion. I'm actually a trained pharmacist, so I was always inspired by innovations, and digital fashion is where fashion and new technologies meet. So I'm very inspired by the new world's opening now. And with Tracy, who is with us now, we developed, or we launched, the first digital jewelry collections. So Tracy is going to introduce herself as well, but we digitized the unique jewelry Tracy is designing. And now we offer with her jewelry also digital twins. So for instance, these earrings, these earrings exist physically, and they are highly adaptable in the augmented reality and can be changed as the NFT owner would like to. So it's an exciting space we are entering with Tracy.
It certainly is. And indeed, we ought to point out, I mean, if Mel, if you was to shake your head, you've got your digital jewelry on, and Tracy, you have as well, haven't you?
Yes.
And you can just see, I haven't, right? And so you can just see how, if you look at the three girls on screen who have put their earrings on today, I don't know why the boys didn't, but the girls have. And so you can see, you can look how gorgeous that is. Look at Mel, and look at Tracy, and look at Susanna and myself. And, you know, it's they're all just looking equally as gorgeous. And Tracy, you're the designer of this. So tell us a little bit about you and why you took your art into NFT space. Over to you.
Well, thank you very much for having me. Good morning. My name is Tracy Greenan. I'm the founder of a digital jewelry brand called Aurelia Nicris. We started in Stockholm, Sweden. We're now based in New York City. I started as a shoe designer in 1990, and I've moved my way through fashion through the years, and began jewelry a few years ago. And I met Susanna, was it last year? We met through a Clubhouse talk. I'd heard about digital fashion a while ago, and I was really curious about it. I wanted to pursue it, and then I just got distracted with everyday business. And it wasn't until I got contacted from Lauren Kasher, who's the founder of Ultrush, a very chic avant-garde digital fashion label, to do a talk with Susanna. And we met there. We collaborated on the Metaverse starter kit for style lovers, which is a great entry point if you for Metaverse rookies who are interested in fashion to start their NFT collection or add to their own. It's very exciting, and I've started producing some of my own digital earrings, and in the works of doing some more. Very excited about the future of digital fashion.
Thank you so much, Tracy. Can you tell us again what you just said? What was that startup community that you were in, so that we can tell the listeners?
Oh, you're talking about the Metaverse starter set for style
Metaverse
lovers.
Okay. Yes. Metaverse starter set for style lovers.
Lovers, yes.
Wonderful, wonderful. Well, thank you so much. And you're getting great comments about all of these wonderful digitals, which of course, you know, also brings us all into the new vocabulary that's emerging. And in fact, Sherrod, wasn't it just last November that NFT first, you know, was recognized by the Collins Dictionary? Am I correct?
Yeah, it was the word of the year for 2021. And, you know, that got a lot of conversation started. And there were more than 10,000 articles in 30 days relating to Metaverse and NFTs.
Wow. And, you know, I'm sure, as Mosey was saying earlier about, you know, the size of the market, and I was mooting that 1.5 trillion, that, you know, everything is just sort of burgeoning daily, isn't it? And in fact, Moses, can I come back over to you now? I think you had your hand up anyway, but yeah, can you sort of just wrap this conversation and just give us a little bit more meat, perhaps about around Web3, perhaps around Meta, and then into NFT and whatever you were going to add? Over to you, Moses.
I just wanted to request that our dynamic duo demonstrate some of their other jewelry. I really like the headdresses that you were making.
Yeah, yeah, that will come later, Moses. We've got some surprises. Don't kill the game, boy. Yeah, so I can see Sherrod smiling because he's got a surprise for you.
I have some fancy glasses, which I'll try on a little later.
Yeah, yeah, no, thanks, Moses. Thank you so much. But while we've got you, do you want to stretch something out? And then, Timothy, I'm coming over to you for NFT. So, Moses, you know, what is this all about? How can we play? Go on, give us a quick minute on that, please.
Yeah, I also wanted to distinguish between NFTs, DeFi, and VR Metaverse.
Please.
I think that Metaverse is just a user contact mode. So a touch point could be mobile, it could be ATMs, or it could be by email. I think that Metaverse AR and VR is simply another way of touching the customer and being customer intimate. Our interest is primarily around DeFi and NFTs. And the reason they're interesting is because the financial, decentralized financial technologies can allow for the optimization of transactions. So if you have a lot of transactions happening, you can actually accelerate them. For example, if you sell jewelry and they're somewhat expensive, if you could embed a financing plan into that, that's all DeFi based, it would actually increase your sales. So I think those kinds of DeFi technologies are very interesting. And the reason that we're so interested in DeFi as it pertains to NFTs is that we think that they're going to be, well, DeFi is already huge. It's like a multi-billion dollar market, but it's only the beginning. And what will happen in the future is you'll see things like what we call the basketization of NFTs. So right now, NFTs are non-fungible. So they're kind of illiquid and you can't sell them. So you buy a piece of art and then you enjoy it. However, if you get tired of it and you do want to sell it, if you put it into a basket of many things, for example, if you have a digital signature of a rock and roll star, if you have one for each of the band members and you package them together, it would actually be worth more than just a single digital signature or a set list or an NFT of that. So we think that once you basketize, you have portfolios and you can do what's called portfolio optimization on these baskets. And that's where it gets very interesting because optimization technologies are very complex and difficult right now, but they're inventing these new computers called quantum computers that can solve optimization problems up to a million times faster. So every major financial services company like Goldman Sachs and every Citibank and all the other banking organizations are doing early experiments in quantum computing because these computers actually exist now. And a few of them have been proven to work at the 1 million X improvement rather than, you know, in venture capital, we look for the 10X multiplier. This is a 1 million X multiplier. So oh, wow. Everyone's chasing after that. And it's hard to imagine how your business can change when your business model contains a 1 million times improvement over your competition. And at that point, what we talk about isn't, you know, business model canvases. We talk about business model warfare, and that you can actually, it's a really terrible analogy right now with what's happening in Ukraine, But
is
there
indeed,
is more,
let's drop the warfare.
No, we'll drop that. But I think a better analogy we use is the Cambrian explosion. The Cambrian explosion 150 billion years ago was when single-celled organisms figured out how to combine and become multicellular life. And then at that point, there was this massive explosion of different life forms. And then as evolution went, kickstarted and took it up many orders of magnitude, it actually evolved very, very quickly to what we know. So we think that NFTs and DeFi and Web3 is equivalent to a Cambrian explosion of technologies. And if you look at the Cambrian explosion, it was actually just one tiny little mutation that did it. It's when the cell mutated the ability to connect together and form cell walls that produced that. That one tiny mutation caused the entire, the greatest event in the history of life on Earth. And I think that that event for technology is the blockchain.
Well, that's an incredible analogy as well. And as well, I mean, not to use something that's affected us all in the last couple of years, but also being quite curious, but and maybe given us the space to all find ourselves zooming around on Zoom on and not on a 747. And of course, that is the single cell mutation of Corona and COVID. But let's take those analogies and you know, the sort of background and the space that we're in. And let's take it over to you, Timothy, as I was mooting, and bring it into Hong Kong, and where you're consulting for your community almost as an NFT trader. I mean, can you tell us about this and maybe pop in a bit of branding in there, Timothy?
So I think, you know, I think everyone has to build their own understanding of the metaverse and Web3 and what it means for them. I think for me, basically, you know, I like geeky things. So, you know, I bought my first NFT just to try, you know, just to see how it works, create my wallet and kind of go through the process. But what really amazed me and why I'm still here 6 months later was to see how the communities around NFTs were actually being built. And as a digital brand builder myself, I was amazed. I was like, our clients in the traditional industry are not as engaged as anyone that I see in the NFT industry. And I was also seeing really the creativity, like the creativity is limitless if you think about building digital assets, but also tying it to physical experiences. I mean, I'm a huge believer that, of course, you know, there is the art space that is huge on NFT collection. Me, I'm really more interested into how NFT will bridge physical and the digital world. I'm going to drop an article in the chat about how Coinbase kind of try to give the definition of what the metaverse is. But if I can just leave it there, you know, the metaverse is just, it's a whole ecosystem, right? It's not anybody wearing VR goggles and going into a virtual world to be their own avatar. That's a very small piece of what the metaverse is. The metaverse is a huge ecosystem that's powered by blockchain, that offers new possibilities. But most importantly, you know, what brands need to think about, especially in fashion, and of course you see a lot of luxury fashion going into the space now with, you know, Gucci, Prada. The key is really for them to build like meaningful stories. And it's, you know, it's a lot about marketing today, but more and more it's going to be about real experiences, about access. And then of course you have the wearables part, which is, you know, buying NFTs for the actual avatar, which you may have. But as most of people know here, I'm sure, not many of us have an avatar in the metaverse today. And, you know, that's still going to take a while, but it doesn't mean that NFTs are not going to, you know, take over your life in the next couple of years. You know, every brand is going to want a piece of it. So I'm going to drop an article that I invite people to look at in the future. There's a very nice kind of ecosystem diagram there, and hopefully it will help everyone to get a sense of what the metaverse can be.
Thank you, Timothy. That's great. I'm actually going to leave it there, but come back to you on branding in a tad. And I feel compelled actually to go over to you, Mel. So sort of to give some sort of, if you like, some product reality around this from the art space. And, you know, I know you had a wonderful conversation last night about how to be an NFT artist, and I think you've got some real tangible sort of irons in the NFT fire, or the metaverse fire, so to speak. Mel, can you put some sort of actuality to what Timothy was just saying?
Sure. I think I already mentioned it before, but I think like the biggest thing for artists is it's really opened up new markets that weren't there. And it did this by attracting artists in around the concepts that come with the blockchain and NFTs, that you can assign ownership and record that on the blockchain, and it's transparent so everyone can see that, and that can't be easily disputed. Now, there have been lots of problems that have come along with that, you know. There's been a lot of scammers and spammers trying to steal and do things with that. But the reality is that it is still recorded there. And there is one owner for an NFT, and it's recorded on the blockchain. Now, what that does that's so interesting to me is it actually frees up the art. It actually frees up the art for everyone to enjoy, because we don't have to be confused about who owns it. We can all enjoy it, and we can look back to the blockchain and say, oh, this is the person that actually owns it. So if they want to sell it, this is the person that's going to sell it and get the funds. So it eliminates a lot of confusion. So I think these are some of the key points instead of drawn artists in. But I think the real thing is, like, for me, I had a difficult time as a traditional artist breaking into new markets in the traditional real art world. There's so much gatekeeping that's happened there. This has just really been like the floodgates of artists being able to connect peer-to-peer, person-to-person with collectors, whether it be an individual or a gallery. And you don't see this type of stuff happening in the traditional art markets because, like I said, there's so much gatekeeping, so many old systems and strategies that have been put in place that prevent this from happening, particularly for new or emerging artists. So the metaverse, the ability to transact and with NFTs and on the blockchain has really opened up new things for artists. And I think with the earrings, it's like, it's innovation. It's like, we have the opportunity to not only see new things, be inspired by new things, and try new things. So it's really like a huge playground for artists. And I'm really happy that they're here at the beginning, because it gives us the opportunity to lend our creative voice. And I don't think that, I mean, it's kind of, I think it happened like a little bit coincidentally, like artists just kind of got involved early, like it was an easy space for them to come into. And I think that it's really good coincidence, because we're here to kind of set the foundation and use that like visionary aspect to really influence and shape the metaverse. Like, that's why I'm so excited to be here. So thank you, Susan.
Yeah, no, it is indeed. I mean, it's sort of, I'm not going to bring you in, Moses, and I'm glad you're back, because we thought we'd lost you, but that, you know, consulting, and indeed, so it's so, you know, yeah, inspiration can now really be turned into a new word, fidget, something fidgetal, which is awesome. But I mean, you know, let's sort of take that, that there are some polarities when we come into, break into any new market, when we break into any new space. I mean, even when we go to a party, you know, there's polarities in the room, you know, the light and the dark, the, you know, the dancing and the still, and, you know, that you're feeling a little bit nervous or you're feeling very bold. So all of, in this eco environment, in this system, we need the tech, Alberto. So I'm glad you're smiling again. You almost knew I was going to come into you. So, you know, when we're on this journey, I mean, and as Mel just stressed, it's sort of almost the very early gateway in this journey. You know, what should we be doing in order to, if you like, protect the canvas, protect the modeling, the quantum, and what can we learn from what's happened to date, Alberto? Over to you.
That's a very interesting question. And I think that in general, it's cool that artists and art is like a avant-garde into this space, as it is discovering how, let's say, NFTs and in general, the digital trading of art in this case is done. But my, let's say, my perspective and my interest lies more in what then the companies on a larger scale can do for like the general population. And that's where I look at, let's say, this problem. And it's for a company now today, it's interesting to reason and to think about what does it mean to own their IPs? What are their IPs and their products? They're not anymore, at least, just the physical goods that they sell. But more and more, it's going to become like the NFT is just an example. It's a tool, but it can be like whatever kind of digital assets that then is traded onto one of the platforms on the Met. It could be the Metaverse platform or whatever else. And well, today Facebook has somewhat stolen this Metaverse and Meta term, but what I envision and what my opinion again is that there's a variety of platforms and technologies that can be used. Even Minecraft could be its own small, let's say. And I know, in fact, there is I don't recall the name exactly, but there is like a platform that is very similar to Minecraft that is based on Metaverse concepts that has been developed in recent years. And so going back to what I was saying, it's as a company, I think that the digital strategy and the Metaverse strategy should think about, okay, how can I then take these new ideas and new concept and digital assets that I can produce, and how can I monetize this? How can I get brand awareness? And where is the right place? Today, probably it's too early to say, because it's everything is so new. And I saw in the chat before that somebody mentioned like the size of the NFT market, which is relatively small. I mean, in dollar, it's not that small, but in people, let's say, it's relatively small. And probably just like it happened for Web 1 and Web 2, Web 3 will take some time for then find its footing and find the right platform and the right technologies. And as Moses mentioned before, it's just like finding the right tools and the right access points to these technologies, and then for people to engage with companies and to companies to give to their customers the right product in the right space. It could be digital earrings, as we saw today. That this is to me really interesting, because it's a reality that you can use today with your work from home and with the actual meeting or webinars that we are doing. And so it is slowly becoming easier and easier, especially as the technology become more available to everybody.
Well, thank you for that really good sort of overview and sort of touching on so many points there. And indeed, I've got a feeling I'm sort of going to sort of combine a couple of sort of things I've heard. I think I heard this from you last time we spoke, Alberto, you know, about, you know, creators in this space, and I suppose in any space, but want information of a seemingly complex process so that they can simplify and indeed become simplified. And I'm going to come over to you, Sunil, to sort of talk to us around this, but also to bring in Jamie Brett, who is with MetaHub and was on our panel on January 25th. And Jamie very much spoke about digital economic justice, and a sort of Mel sort of touched on this a little bit as well. So Sunil, as I pop it into you to sort of help us navigate how we can play and what we could play with, you know, just sort of that complexity, how do you make it simple, and how do you make this an environment that's, you know, on one hand, as someone's put in the chat, you know, taken in a centralized way, maybe by some of the more a Web 2 organizations at the same time opening this space for the ownership economy and the decentralized area that Web 3 energy brings with it. Sunil, can you take that one?
Yeah, sure. Basically, what I am onto in my current journey, I'm basically simplifying the process of digital fashion adoption as well as metaverse adoption for fashion and lifestyle brands and sourcing companies. And by putting their physical collections into a digital form and connecting NFTs, putting them onto my marketplace and creating avatars and trying those avatars, and then you are in a position to take those avatars into any social media, meetings, events, games, or metaverses, or uses as collectibles, I'm in a position to provide them an ecosystem which is giving them genuinely an extra earning stream from digital only side of things, which is relatively low investment, complete IP protection kind of a scenario, an authenticity for the consumers to work upon and buy that. And genuinely, all this has come out and been speeded up by the pandemic and adoption of technology and adoption of the digital landscapes more in the pandemic side of things. Genuinely, completely sustainable, no wastage, environment protection, and no carbon footprint. So those kind of scenarios. And it is giving you a possibility of a level field for budding designers to match and to probably compete with the LVs of the world. So this kind of a concept, a metaverse concept, a digital scenario concept is giving you all these possibilities. These possibilities are also giving the possibility, a reachability for smaller brands to go global. Possibility of portability and integration onto new digital environments and attracting a new set of consumers who are looking at digital only side of things. This is only possible out of metaverse. So this has given a great advantage to people and to great advantage to the fashion industry and lifestyle industry in a big way. And I'm simplifying that process for them to adopt and be on this bandwagon and achieve a different level of things out of that.
Well, thank you so much, Sunil. I mean, beautifully explained, and it sort of gives a real good segue into those that have made it happen. So I'm going to come to you, Susanna, to sort of talk to us about, you know, what sort of commitment you had to make to get into space and make it real, like you and Tracy have held hands and done. And I just, before we do that, I just want to honor everyone that's putting lovely commentary in the chat. I encourage our panelists to have a quick look. And Tracy, there's some points for you in the Q&A about theaters and costumes and how you can take your digital into that space. So Susanna, I mean, you know, you've got in, you know, what is it all like in there? What's the commitment like? And is it any different than, you know, a Web 2 business? Over to you, Susanna.
Yeah, and Susanna, if I may just add, can you also explain to our participants what kind of investment, you put into setting up your business in the metaverse? And in what time frame did you set it up? Thank you.
Yeah, great. Thank you for the question. I started with being aware about digital fashion at the end of 2020, when we were all sitting at home, right? And sitting on Zoom calls 10 hours a day, and wondering if we really need to style ourselves for the meetings physically, or isn't it possible with one click? just like to put on a jewelry and so on. And just like Sunil said, the technology is not that far, but since I've always loved jewelry, and I think jewelry is the exclamation mark of each outfit, it was the right way to go. So beginning of just about 1 year ago, I was talking with my sister, who is my second arm in this project. We built this together, and we were talking a lot which way to go, and we wanted to create a sustainable solution for the fashion industry to have a style with one click, sustainable, and with the eyes or with the vision in the future in the metaverse. And this was our focus. So I think the filters are one point, but as Sunil also and also Alberto already talked about, the usability also for the virtual world is also the second standpoint. So we aim to collaborate with avatar companies to be able to style the avatars and to continue this journey, because I think Timothy, you mentioned that it's a small it's going to be just a small part to have an avatar and sit with the VR headset, but it's going to communicate together the AR and the VR. And just imagine you could have a virtual jewelry box or a virtual wardrobe, and you, with one click, you can wear whatever you want. And this is also what Timothy said, it's limitless. The creativity can explode. You can wear whatever you want completely sustainably. Nothing has to be produced. And if it's produced, you can bring more value with the virtual accessories and augment the style and put it further. So I think the physical and the virtual world will collaborate together, and we will find beautiful solutions there. And so we started about 1 year ago, and we launched the platform end of October in a beta version with just three designs to test a little bit the market, because it's a new market. We are really the first ones still focused on virtual jewelry and making all of the designs on our platform wearable right away. So we collaborate with designers around the world. It's not me who is designing the jewelry, but for instance, Tracy here or other designers from around the world, which is also the beauty of the virtual world, that anyone can be a designer. You just need a computer and creativity, and you can reach customers anywhere else in the world. So we create with this designer, we collaborate with these designers, and we bring their jewelry to life. For now, we are still self-funded. We are in collaborations with some funding institutions and with investors and so on. It's, as I said in the beginning, it was founded out of passion for fashion, and we really invest all our energy and resources into this project. So we are very happy to collaborate with so many inspiring people on the way.
Well, I think you're going to get lots of people really hooked on this and coming into you tonight, Susanna. I can already see loads in the chat, so no doubt you're picking them up. I don't know. I mean, Sharad, your glasses are looking a bit steamy. I mean, can you do anything there? Is there anything you can?
I need apply? Some more time to set that up, Susan.
Oh, all right. Okay. Well, could you do Tracy? It?
I think
because they're looking very steamy. So I think you ought to start now. And yes, indeed, you've read my mind. Tracy, I'm going to come over to you, and I want to talk about success, because we always like to sort of see if we can see the face of success. I mean, you know, how do you feel it's been since you've gone with your digital jewelry online? Are you feeling an energy of success? Where do you see it going forward, Tracy?
It's an ongoing learning process. The space is constantly evolving. The main thing for me is educating my traditional buying clients. So that's going to be a big challenge, but I'm very positive that we're going to get there over time. We need to get the visuals out there, and we need to get them all the benefits out there, how that would benefit them in this space. So it's going to take some time, but I'm quite excited about the future of digital jewelry.
So can you go back to that bit then? So that sounds very real, that your client base that you've grown and nurtured over the years, you're now looking at helping them, if they would like, migrate, if you like, some or all of their business into Web3, Metaverse, and possibly NFT. So how's the conversations going? I mean, number one, are they open to the conversation or are they closed? And if they're open, is it a vibrant and is it just getting stuck at the boardroom door, or sort of what's the playing field like out there when you're talking business around Metaverse?
The feedback that I'm getting is, well, we've heard about beauty filters, but we haven't heard about jewelry filters. What is that? How is it going to benefit me? And I think one of the main things, how it will benefit them, is unlike physical jewelry, which degrades, digital jewelry doesn't. And you can wear it wherever you want to go. And it's creative. So you can build your own fantasy. You can have something that you were a bit too shy about wearing in real life. You can just put it on online, and then you can have fun with it. You can freshen up. How many Zoom calls do we have in a day? You can freshen up a screen so easily. And sometimes you can have it subtle. Sometimes you can have it more vibrant. It depends on your choice. Things like that. It's a very exciting space to be in.
Yeah, well, I'm loving that dexterity, and I am with you. Being on sometimes 10 back-to-back calls a day, and some requiring a jacket, some not requiring a jacket, so to speak. You know, and just to pop one on, I'm loving it. And do you know what? I hadn't really sort of considered the let's say almost the familiarity that we often have now with beauty filters, or the filters on your iPhone camera that you use, with now just the filters of, say, for example, digital jewelry. So thank you for bringing that to life for me, Tracy, and hopefully others on screen. And so, Moses, do you feel that I could come to you and talk a little bit more about, you know, this innovation consulting side, and what's the commitment to get into all of this? And indeed, what about if we have to get out? I mean, is it too soon to talk about the out? Is it all about the in? Over to you, Moses.
Yeah. What I'd like to talk about is a lot of times people that start new companies and businesses are so dazzled by the technology, they stop thinking about the business requirements. So for example, for digital art, if you could think about the motivations of collectors, what do collectors really want? So we've actually worked with people who own billion-dollar art collections. And to studying them, we found that there were four types of motivations. There were experiential collectors. So for example, if you're collecting rare cars, they're the ones who actually drive the rare cars. They want to feel the driving of it. There are financial collectors that want the appreciation value. There are series completers. They just want to buy one of every year. I went to a museum once where a guy actually bought every Le Mans winner for 50 years by Porsche. You know, it was actually amazing. A room full of million-dollar Porsches, but he had to have every single year in order to feel complete. And the one that was most interesting to me is what is called the contemplative collector. They actually think about it, and they eventually become curators, and their collections become museums. So I think the most important thing to develop for the NFT art market is to associate with a large museum and create a museum of NFT art that would assign value through curatorship. As the first, digital earrings that are both physical and digital, it'll make an amazing display. And to have like the Museum of Modern Art bless you and say, "Oh, this is art," would increase the value of your work and bring it to the market. So if you look at the needs of the collectors and do what we call design ethnography. So ethnography is this technique that we do things called design sprints that help you kind of dig into the psychology of what your customer really wants. By figuring that out, you can actually be more successful. So these design sprints, like for example, Google Ventures does a design sprint for every single project they do. So it kind of, in a week, you could figure it out. And that's what I recommend, is to do a metaverse design sprint around any project you're doing to understand the underlying motivational needs of collectors, of the marketplace, of the NFT creator, and the entire ecosystem to figure that out. So that's sort of what we do in our work.
Moses, I mean, thank you very much for bringing it back to, if you like, the creating the rich picture of your canvas or your quantum plan. And it's very absolutely right. I love those descriptions of the profiles. Maybe we'll grab those, Sharad, and we'll put them in a post later. But of course, that sort of does dovetail or dances beautifully back to you, Timothy, into the branding space. And so can you sort of talk to us a little bit about, do different types of collectors and personalities have to have different brands in the metaverse and in NFTs? And indeed, are we able to sort of slightly tweak the product more easily than we are, for example,
I wanted to go back to one thing that Susanna said earlier, which, she started everything, with Tracy, like from the ground up, through passion. I'm sure she's partnering with people from all around the world. And this is really the huge shift that is going to happen in the fashion world in the next few years, because you're gonna have the ability for small, creators and shop to really put their brand out there like never before. And I think, the big brands, that's what you see in the news, right? The big brands, the Gucci doing an NFT collection, Prada, that's what you see in the news. But actually, one of the reasons these brands are going in, it's because they know they need to learn, because the smaller brands are moving a lot faster and they're making decisions a lot faster. And you can see a brand like Artifact Studio. So Artifact Studio, you guys should look it up, for whoever is listening, is the digital fashion studio that got acquired by Nike for an undisclosed amount, but probably $500 million. And that's really the huge shift that's happening now for brands. And the reason why Nike bought Artifact is because the Artifact Studio branding and storytelling was just the best that you had in the digital, pop culture. Like, they were doing sneakers and things like that. And I think right now, so many fashion brands are creating their own ecosystem. And I would give an advice, if there are any big brands, people listening, I would say, you have two ways to grow. Either you build your own team in-house to really build these projects and you let them do their thing 100% of their time, a dedicated team, or you have to look outside and acquire people. You really have very interesting projects that are, mixing, again, digital and so I'm consulting a project, just to mention quickly. They are also going to produce digital wearables footwear, but they are already, we're lining it up to a factory in Asia to actually forge or like build that footwear to be delivered to the NFT owner. And the type of footwear that is being produced right now, also with 3D printing and technology, is just a crazy new world of fashion. So it's like there's a lot of things coming together right now. You know, 3D printing, everybody was saying, ah, oh, it's going to be the new thing for everybody. And then nothing happened, really. But these things are kind of coming back together now. So, but what I do is a lot of projects have amazing technology. They have amazing art, amazing creators. But like in everything, the branding and the story really matters, how you engage with the community. The great thing about this world is also that when you create community, especially on Discord, I mean, I don't know if you guys know Discord, but most communities today are on Discord. I'm sure there's going to be the next big thing that's going to be easier to use for more people. But you're getting so much feedback from your customers that is helping you to build your business. And this is today something that is very difficult to do in the traditional industry and in the traditional way. This is just, very exciting. I think there's going to be a lot of, there's also a lot of bad brands out there with everything and everything, but I'm sure
we could hone in on pitfalls and our predictions for that. But thank you so much, Timothy. And I love the sort of stress on community and collaboration and supporting, etc. I'm sure most of our audience today have heard of Discord, but maybe some haven't. So can you just stick that in the chat for us, please? Sharad, I'm wondering, we've just gone past top of the hour. Do we have anybody that we'd like to call in from the audience?
Yeah, I actually want to recognize Leila Hostel. I met her some 2 weeks back, and I've just got her as a panelist. I think she's camera shy, but she can speak to us from wherever she is. Oh, there she is. So Leila is a very young lady who has entered the metaverse in a big way. And I'd love for her to share her story with the audience and with our other panelists. So Leila, your 3 minutes start now.
Hi, nice to meet everyone. I'm so sorry, I'm having some issues with my virtual background. I'm not sure why this is happening. So I think I'll just remove my camera for now, but at least you got to see part of my face. But I'll just introduce myself quickly. I'm studying economics and business at UCL. And I'm the founder of a few companies, but I'll put the focus on, I'm launching an NFT collection called the All Stars Women NFT Club and DAO, which is a collection of 10,000 futuristic female avatars. And the aim is to gather a community of female founders and entrepreneurs and give them the resources that they need in order to make their businesses a success. And we're gonna be creating a DAO. And this DAO will be backing a fund, and the money raised from the minting of this collection is gonna be invested into this fund. And this fund is gonna be invested into the female founders' startups, and then the profits will be redistributed to the community. And we're gonna be hosting a webinar tomorrow at 5 p.m. UAE time. So it's 1 p.m. UK time. And we will be discussing the importance of building an inclusive metaverse. So we think that Web3 and virtual worlds are actually impacting the way that we live and that we communicate with each other. And so we think that it's still like a white canvas, and there's a strong opportunity to create a better society, make it more inclusive. And I think that it's now or never for women to seize this opportunity and leave their mark on the metaverse.
Thank you, Leila. And just for our panelists and the audience, this webinar is tomorrow at 5 p.m. Dubai time, entitled yes. Building an All-Inclusive Metaverse. So stay tuned for that one. If you haven't already registered, you can do so at onlywebinars.com. May I, Susan, just recognize one more participant, and that is Rish Lotlikar. He's the co-founder of Superworld. I've been tracking him on LinkedIn, and I think he's a major player in the metaverse. So your 3 minutes start now, Rish.
Hey, how's it going, everyone? My name is Rish Lotlikar, co-founder and CEO of Superworld. It's a pleasure to be here. You know, I wanted to kind of give you a quick overview on kind of what we're doing, and I think what we're thinking about in the market. Superworld is a virtual world built on top of the real world. We enable anyone and empower anyone to create, discover, and monetize anything, anywhere in augmented reality around them in the real world. We've divided the surface of the earth into 64 billion virtual blocks of properties. So each property is a unique digital asset. If you buy a property in Superworld covering any place in the world, you get a share of any of the economics that happen there. Advertising, e-commerce, digital commerce, data, analytics, and gaming. And I would say that our differentiation, what we're focused on at Superworld, it might sound ironic, but we're building a virtual world that is focused on the real world and people's real lives. We want to be a life-enhancing platform and not a life-escaping platform. So we don't want to pull you into Superworld, but quite the opposite. What we want to do is leverage these technologies, AR, VR, blockchain, and AI, to, again, improve whatever people are doing in their real lives, in their physical lives, their analog lives. And so we have a concept called live to earn, which is how do we utilize tokenomics to actually, again, incentivize people's passions. How do I get Nike to pay for you to go to a run? How do I get, you know, Virgin Unite to help, you know, pay for you to do something positive for the community? You know, the idea is, again, how do we enhance your real life and things that you're passionate about in the real world? And then collectively, how do we take all this activity that we're all doing to enhance the real world? So as an example of that, you know, when you buy land in Superworld, you know, we plant trees in the real world. We're partnered with the World Bank in the Caribbean to help with the hurricane disaster relief. We've partnered with the United Nations and UNESCO to help rebuild cities like Beirut, Lebanon. In fact, about a month ago, we brought together two tribes in the Amazon jungle to create digital art in the Amazon, viewable from anywhere, to help people understand the issues that are happening with the reforestation in the Amazon jungle. And so again, you know, to summarize, we've built a virtual world on top of the real world that enhances people's real lives, enhances the real world, and enables all of us as stakeholders to own the world around us and to create, discover, and monetize anything, anywhere.
Thank you, Rish.
Thanks.
Back to you, Susan.
Oh, thank you so much, Leila and Rish. Thank you. That's very brave of you to step out from the audience onto screen here. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Mel, I've just seen you pop up the news of your new program and your new course. What's all this about, and how that will that help everyone in the room today?
Yeah, I'm really, really excited. As Susan mentioned yesterday, I gave a free event and there was a massive, massive turnout of people. So I started a 6-week course to elaborate on that information. It's going to start at the very beginning. If you don't even have a wallet yet for interacting with Web3, we start at the very beginning. So you can have a wallet and we go all the way through. If you already are an NFT artist, we're going to cover some concepts that will impact you, like utility and rarity. And we're going to take all the way out in the 6 weeks. We're going to talk about what you do when you are successful, like Susan was mentioning. When you are successful, what are you going to do? What does that look like? What does that feel like? And in Web3, you can allow your earnings to continue working for you. So we'll talk about how you might reinvest those into virtual land or other options. So super excited to be sharing this information with people. Thanks for giving me the opportunity to speak about it, Susan. So I put a link over there. You can registration's open now. And until tomorrow, I've got my entry pricing. There's a discount till tomorrow because I launched yesterday with my free event. So thanks so much.
Well, that's kind of you, Mel. Thank you so much. And sort of Moses, I'm sort of feeling to come over to you now, because, you know, a lot of what we're speaking about here is creating and, you know, bringing our, let's say, our passion, whether it's into fashion or whatever it is in this space. And so that brings me into IP or intellectual property, Moses. I know you've done an awful amount of work around this and you know, holding safe and sound or not on blockchain. And you've got some great examples, for example, like the post office. Can you talk to us about economic justice and intellectual property, you know, in this space that we're walking into, Moses?
I'm not the person with economic justice. That was someone else.
No, I'm just giving you a little phrase there. Okay. Yeah, that was Jamie. That was Jamie Brett from last time. Yeah.
Sure. So the intellectual property, going back to my example about the Cambrian explosion, what drove that was evolution and changes in how things are done. So if you just copycat someone else's NFT or, you know, metaverse technology, it doesn't really drive warfare evolution of business models. And innovation is the evolution of business. So I think that it's important to create IP around what you're doing. For example, if you first look at, like we're working with a musician around NFTs, and if you look at their business model, they can't make money streaming anymore, right? So when you had a gold record, you know, 20 years ago, you'd make about $50,000 for a gold record in royalties. But if you get 1 million listens on Spotify now, is about $20 of revenue. So you aren't making any money by selling music the traditional way. So they're making money in concerts. So what we thought of is, and we have a patent for this, is proximity awareness for your NFT. So if your NFT smart contract can work with an app that can tell if you're at a concert, it can add value to your NFT. And for example, if you go to 10 concerts, suddenly you automatically get a backstage pass. So those kinds of things can actually draw more people to concerts and create revenue flow. And that is something you would do around patentability. Now, in terms of, you know, fashion, what I would do immediately is proximity awareness for fashion, because I don't think two people want to show up with the exact same dress, right? Especially if the dress cost you $10,000 for an NFT for that dress or that jewelry. So what you want to know is someone else going to show up? And is there someone to make sure that this NFT smart contract says that nobody in the virtual room or ballroom I'm at can wear the same dress as me, but you're still allowed to sell it to other people. And that the first one to sign up through some system would do that. So I think you can actually develop technologies, but the key to that is to actually step back and look at the underlying business models and needs of everyone in the ecosystem to design these technologies at a more comprehensive level. Because many inventors tend to create half-baked ideas, and they're so exciting, you just have to do it because you feel that's there. And what we suggest is doing a design sprint to fully bake a half-baked idea before you spend a lot of money on it.
Well, that's really got me quite fired up there. I mean, how interesting is that proximity awareness for fashion? Susanna, do you want to just speak a little, or you or Tracy just want to speak a little bit to that? And then I'm coming to you, Alberto, for some tech. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. I think the value is really important with real creating, and the Web3 is about value, and it is about bringing your own value also to the community and keeping what you own as well through the decentralized system. What I wanted to say and add to Moses, it should be something that you own, right? You shouldn't share it, and it should be protected. I think this is because I was disturbed by somebody who wrote it in the chat that you can just take a screenshot, and it's not what an NFT is about. So this is exactly what the Web3 is bringing to us, this value and this protection of ownership, and what Moses is saying. Yeah, and this is also why we feel so comfortable by sharing the source files of the designs to the community, because everybody knows where the design comes from because it's protected with a decentralized system. So this is so important.
No, you explained that so well, and also thank you for giving a bridge into the chat room and then pulling it back into this room and getting some reality around that. It's not about screenshot, but it's about owning and collecting and sharing with community. So Tracy, I mean, when you're designing, how do you feel about the thought now that your one wonderful design can now go out to so many? How does that feed you?
Well, one thing I keep in mind is I want to express to my clients what's going to give them value, what Susanna was touching on, and what an NFT should express who somebody is. So I'm exploring the space of having customizable pieces. That's something that I'm creating in a collection right now that I'm really excited about. It's going to be tricky, but it's something that I really think is important for people, that they want to have something to say, this is who I am, this is something I can be excited about.
Love
and
it.
Also, I want it to be authentic and on brand. I think that's really important. We can't just create an NFT just for the sake of creating an NFT. It's got to have something that's saying, okay, this is Aurelian Icarus. We know because this is the style of the brand. So we got to keep on brand.
Okay, well then thank you for that, because that, Alberto, hang on to your seat, because I'm going to just take that brand and throw it over to Timothy, because I've been threatening to come to Timothy on branding. So
really briefly? Can I say one thing really briefly?
Who's that? Oh, it's Moses. Moses. Yes.
I just want to respond to the two artists. I think that digital provenance is something to consider because these NFTs for collectors can provide a better form of provenance. And one of the things we've been looking at is laser engraving an NFT onto auto car parts, so that when they put them into a collector car, that you could nest the NFT of the parts into the NFT of the collectible. Or you could nest the canvas producer or even the oil producer for a painting. So you can have this entire provenance trail that could increase the value of your work. And then the final thing I want to mention before you give it to Timothy is branding. Branding and art have one thing in common. It's about meaning. People buy art because it gives meaning to your life. You buy jewelry because it shows the meaning of your life. And understanding that is actually, I think, the key to success in the digital art world, is that owning a Beeple is actually more than just the art. It's like I bought that, and the bragging rights for owning that kind of thing. So understanding that a brand is essentially a totem of meaning that you put on, saying I own this, therefore I'm richer, I'm happier, or whatever. Figuring out that as the underlying primitive for branding is, I think, a very important key.
Thank you, Moses. I'm glad you tripped in there. Although I'm sort of going to hope that the polarity comes from bragging rights to just, emotional and those feeling happy rights more than the bragging. But Timothy, what branding? Can you take us in there? Branding and art is the mean equals meaning.
First, I think there are many answers to many different business issues, right? I mean, at the end of the day, brands want to make money, right? So it's not an easy answer, but I think the interesting thing that is happening is there are two things happening very interesting for brands: decentralized marketing and decentralized creation. So today, for a lot of NFT projects built by brands, maybe they hire an agency to do some of the work, maybe they have their in-house team, but actually what really happens is there is a new way to do marketing now for brands in the metaverse, which is really completely decentralized. You might hire someone in Peru, one in Alaska, another one from China, and then you basically have a team that can work on branding and marketing like literally 24/7, because the 24/7 communication to your community is really part of your brand now. So talking about the Artifact Studio and the Nike collection, right? Clonex, which is now one of the top brand in the NFT collectibles world. Their engagement is 24/7. You can never stop to talk to your community, and the community will give you feedback to your brand. So it's kind of that constant being fed from your customers for the brand. So there is that, but at the same time, you of course, you have to be very clear about who your target audience is, because you also need a very strong core target audience. So brands have to plan ahead at least, you know, months in advance of what is the story they're going to want to tell. But the metaverse right now, it's not something you're planning. You don't have like a 2 years roadmap. If anybody who tells you I have a 2 years roadmap on the metaverse as a fashion brand, I'm like, okay, show it to me. Like, no, there's no way. The further you can see right now is probably, you know, half year. You're already very good. And then after you have to move. So, but yeah, strong base, you know, design, logo, story is very strong. But hire people that know what they're doing. That's what I would say.
Well, thank you, Timothy. So 180-day plan maximum, and in fact, probably a 90-day plan is better, times two. So Alberto, in everything that you've just been listening to here, you know, how and where are the pitfalls where it comes to technology, or indeed, where is the freedom and the ability when it comes to technology? Alberto.
Yeah, one thing that I would like to start with is going back to what Susanna said before. It's taking a screenshot of an NFT. It's like taking a photo of a house. You don't own the house. And while the NFT is the actual certificate that attests that you are the property of the house is yours. So that's the same thing, in my mind at least, as a comparison. So in general, I would say, and I totally agree with what Timothy just said, it's very hard to predict the future, especially in an ever-changing scenario such as these that are very new and very changing really every day, and with some major players and big companies that have done very large investment, maybe in a year from now, the things that we are discussing today are not relevant anymore because the technology has completely shifted. So to me, it's important to establish inside of your company or your brand, whatever it is, a strong knowledge base so that the people that deal with these sort of things, digital assets, NFTs, and metaverse scenario, augmented reality, whatever it is, that they know what they're talking about. That's the understanding of the technology is of the utmost importance at this moment. So once you have like a pipeline set up, inside of the company and the brand that can produce digital assets. Those assets, once you have like the landscape clear, can be deployed to whatever platform it is. You want to create an NFT on the Ethereum blockchain. You have the files, you have the stuff, you just create and upload to the right place. Whatever it is, it's to me the most important thing is getting your company ready, meaning that you have the right tools, the right preparation of the people, and also, as Timothy said, somebody that does that 24/7 and that does that knows what it's doing and it's dedicated to creating the digital future of the company and the brands. That if I think about, I don't know, 30 years back, the only thing that was important was actually the product that you deliver to the shelves in the shop. And in 30 years, this has completely changed. Today, a couple of years back, a website from Sweden, I think, Carlings, did a completely digital collection where you you couldn't buy like the physical stuff. And that's like, they were very, futurist in this. But this is, today it's now happening. It's more and more, it's shifting towards the digital, and especially with the IP protection. Your IP is not the product you sell, it's the concept around that. And the only way to me that you can then protect this, also in a court of law, because at the end of the day, as we said, brands want to make money and they want to protect their IP in some way. You gotta like have the proof of that product coming out of you. NFTs are one way. There's other interesting technologies around blockchain and the crypto world that allow you to say, this belongs to me. It came out of my company, it came out of my mind, and I am the owner, or I am the seller, or whatever. But it's very clear how to track from the beginning to the end where the ownership is. And for IP protection, this is
it's crucial. It's critical, Alberto. Definitely. So thank you for, you know, really giving some good stress and stretch on that. And Sunil, you're nodding. I just want to come over to you for sort of a closing line. I mean, actually, you got your hand up, so that's interesting. And then back over then to Sharad. But you know, in this decentralized protocol where there's multi-chains and cross-chains, you know, how do we get into this IP state? You know, what do you see as the doorways and the pitfalls, just very quickly?
Absolutely. So it is not just the IP protection of the brands. It is also the authenticity check of the consumer who is wanting to buy the NFTs. So NFTs give you that possibility also. So there can be a genuine counterfeit management, counterfeit scenario, which can be avoided from the consumer side also. This is also done through, because we are only talking of brands on one side, but on the other side, NFTs are also helping the consumer to buy the things, and they are authentic. The authenticity check is available, as well as they're very, very sure of what they are buying. So that also is given by that. In terms of the pitfalls, yes, presently the technology does not allow avatars to move from one metaverse to another in a very, very smooth way, which is going to be coming. It is still evolving. So those technologies are still evolving. That's one aspect of it. Then the other pitfall, which I see on the fashion side, is that people are talking about collectibles. They're not talking about wearables. Any cloth is a wearable first, then a collectible. So while in the fashion trade right now, luxury goods are being bought as collectibles, as more of an investable scenario, rather than as a wearable scenario. What I'm wanting to change in my company and giving it to the fashion world is that the first thing which they are able to achieve out of their clothing is wearability. The second thing is, of course, the collectability. And the third is investability. So all these three things are going to be coming to the fashion world. And genuinely, any clothing is about wearability. The first usability of any clothing is about wearability. Or how will it happen if Zuzana's and Tracy's collections cannot be worn? You can only own them. It will not look good. So it will not be the right output of that particular thing. The genuine scenario of any jewelry or any wearable item is about wearability of it. The usability is wearability.
This is awesome, Sunil. A great place to sort of bounce back into, Sharad. Wearability, collectability, and investability. Really like it. Sharad, can I send it over to you now?
Yeah, actually, Susan, I don't know if you are keeping track, but we are 90 minutes into our webinar. And I know this can go on forever because, it's so interesting. But I think we need to close now. And it's time for me to thank each one of our panelists for their time, for sharing their knowledge and wisdom. I am certainly enlightened listening to all of you. And I'm sure our audience also has loved this conversation. So thanks to you, Susan, for being our moderator. And I think it's been an amazing experience. Our webinars on metaverse-centric topics will continue. We have another one that is being planned for April and then May and then June as well. So all you have to do is stay connected in our community, onlywebinars.com, and I'll keep you informed of our future activities. So anything you want to add, Susan, before we say final bye to all?
Well, I do indeed. And that is a very big thank you to you all. And I'd like to suggest we all take our mutes off and all say the goodbye to the audience we have in the room. So let's just do that.
Yeah.
Bye.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.
Bye.
Thank you. And see you again soon. Bye.